to today's webinar, Re-entering the Workforce, Finding the Perfect Post-Retirement Career, sponsored by Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I'm the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown, and our presenter today is Talane Miedaner. Today's webinar has been really well received from our alumni community. We had over 80 alums register, so we're thrilled that this has been a great topic and it's been well received. To begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our website. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you're welcome to use one. It is important to note, if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome today. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Talane is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A component. We will also be emailing out the PowerPoint slides afterwards, and they will be available on Facebook, so we'll be going into that later on how you can access that. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. Talane Miedaner is one of our most beloved and favorite webinar presenters and received 2 degrees from Georgetown, her Bachelor's in School of Foreign Service and her Master's, and is the international best-selling author of 3 books, a master certified coach, and the owner and founder of LifeCoach.com. Her clients include executives, professionals, public officials, entrepreneurs, and international leaders. Talane is the author of 3 books, Coach Yourself to Success, which has been reprinted into 8 languages and is an international bestseller, The Secret Laws of Attraction, The Effortless Way to Get the Relationship You Want, and the most recently released, Coach Yourself to a New Career. Talane has appeared in numerous media outlets from Fortune to Newsweek and is a sought-after motivational speaker. I want to thank Talane in advance for sharing her time and expertise, as always, with us today, and I'm going to turn it over to you.
Great. Well, thank you, Emily. And now it's my chance to get to know you guys a little bit. I would do a little quick poll, and you can do this by voting with your on your computer, basically. So we just had a couple of questions. Have you ever attended one of my webinars before? Yes or no?
Just see. All right.
So the newbie.
The poll is launched. We'll give folks a couple of seconds to cast in their votes. All right. The results are in, and it looks like we have a lot of new folks on the line. 74% have not attended a webinar of Talane's before, and 26% have.
Oh, wow, great. Well, welcome to all the new folks who have just joined in, and also already welcome to those who are following and coming back again for another webinar. So I'm delighted. So thank you all for coming. The next question was, have you ever worked with a life coach or business coach, executive coach? Have you ever worked with a coach before? Yes or no?
Right. The results are in again, and 80% have not, and 20% have worked with a life coach or business coach.
Okay, great. Well, that's interesting. And then we had a couple of questions to find out, because of the title being a post-retirement, I was curious, are you currently retired from work and now looking at coming back into work for whatever reason? Yes or no?
Right. Looks like 62% on the line are currently retired and looking to come back into the workforce, and 30% are not.
30% not. So I'm going to guess, actually, maybe that answers our last question, because I would guess that the other 30%, well, we can ask it anyway. Are you currently working now and then planning your ideal retirement career? So what you want to do something different in retirement.
Okay, it looks like 47% are currently working and planning their retirement career. Looks like
okay.
Almost an even break.
Okay, great. Well, that helps me get to know you a tiny bit. It's a bit of a one-way call. I'm often used to doing these calls in an interactive format, but we will take breaks throughout for questions, and you can ask questions at any time, and Emily is going to gather them up for me, and then periodically I'll stop talking so we can answer some of your questions, and so feel free to do that any time. Emily's going to help me out with that. So So what we'll do here is I'm going to start off by just explaining a little briefly about why people use coaching, and so many of you have never used a coach or may not be familiar with that, and what a coach is. So first of all, people use a coach because there's a gap between where they are now and where they want to be. So the bigger the gap, the more you'll benefit from having a coach. Some people don't have a gap, but your coach can help you create a gap. So if you're the kind of person like, well, I don't know what I want to do when I grow up, and you might be 58, that's okay, because we can help you sort that out too. So most often people hire a coach for career reasons. They want to change a career, perhaps they want to start their own business and are nervous or don't know how to do that and want some support as they do that. But also people hire coaches for relationship reasons. They want to improve their relationship, or more often it's that they want to attract Mr. or Mrs. Right into their life. So all those are good reasons for hiring a coach. Generally, people who work with coaches are in some sort of transition or another. And they may be people who feel like, you know, they want more out of life. They want it to really leave a legacy behind them. They want to make sure they've sucked the juice right out of life and have reached their full potential. So for whatever reason, there's all sorts of reasons, and different coaches specialize in different things. But, you know, we can do all of these things and find the right coach for you. So what is coaching? It's not consulting. Consulting assumes that you have a certain information, knowledge, expertise, or experience in a particular field or area. So you hire a consultant because you want specific knowledge or information. Coaching is not therapy either, because we're not necessarily dealing with unresolved issues from the past. That tends to be a therapy topic. It's quite a different and distinct discipline from therapy. They use different approaches, use coaching tools and techniques. It's more forward action, very goal-oriented, very positive. So if you were to compare coaching to anything, the safest bet would be to sports coaching, in that this is an encouraging relationship. It's supportive, inspiring, and challenging. So your coach, you know, might challenge you, but nonetheless, they're, you know, it's going to be a win for you in this sense. You're not out necessarily to beat somebody else, but to win in your own life and create success, whatever terms you decide are success. So that's a little bit about what coaching is and what we do in our company. So we'll go on to we've got a fairly aggressive outline here for the webinar today. We want to cover all these topics, but pretty much what I'm going to do is go through the 9 elements of the perfect career. So we'll look at all these different things, including identifying your natural abilities, finding ways that you can discover your unique talent, looking at what your personal style is, identifying your passions and your values, identifying your personal and emotional needs and how that relates to the career of choice, your interests and goals. We'll talk about some transition tips from either if you're working now, how to transition into that perfect career, or if you're already retired and want to go back into work, some ideas on how to get started with that. So we'll share that. And then at the end, we've got some helpful resources and books, and of course, some wonderful offers for Georgetown alums. So we'll try to hit all of this as well as get some questions in. And if I don't get to your question in this hour today, feel free to contact me. We'll put our contact information at the back, so you can always email me. All right, and of course, I'm on Facebook. So that's what we're going to cover. We'll start off with designing your ideal life. I just want to mention this briefly, because sometimes we forget about this very basic first step. Before you look at a perfect career, the first thing to decide is, what is your ideal life? And that's the first place to look, because your ideal life may be that you're living close to your grandchildren or your children, and that's a part of your ideal life. So the ideal work is going to have to be near them, or work that's virtual. I'm currently living in the United Kingdom and run my business out of New York and have a virtual assistant who lives in Florida. So, and my coaches in my company live all over the U.S. and the world. So, you know, you can actually set up virtual businesses now that run internationally around the world thanks to the Internet. But designing your ideal life, and that was part of my ideal life, to be able to work anywhere. There was a good phone connection so that I could live anywhere in the world. So that's the first piece of it. What is your ideal life look like? Because that is actually the most important question before you think about career, because that can definitely affect then what sort of career would be appropriate once you identify your ideal life. And you can do all sorts of fun things with this. I like, one of my favorite exercises, to flip through a pile of old magazines and just pull out any pictures that appeal to me. You know, thinking, what do I want in my ideal life? And just cut out any pictures or images that represent or would be a part of your ideal life. And then you can start to make a collage on that. Other people like to write down their ideal life. I've even done a very rough sketch of my ideal life with kind of like a little two-year-old would do, with a circle and line drawings to, very basic elementary sketch. So you don't have to have any artistic talent, and you can sketch out an ideal life. This is actually a really powerful exercise. And if you do nothing else from our call today, from this webinar today, I would so encourage you to draw a picture, a sketch, or write down, or make a collage. Do something that that shows what your ideal life is now, what you want to shoot for now. And if you already have your ideal life, fantastic. Carry on with keep that image. You may want to look at what's next for you in this next stage of your life. And that is such a powerful thing because I had lost my picture of the ideal life. It wasn't until I was cleaning out my grandmother's attic and I found these old files and I pulled out this piece of paper and there was my sketch from 10 years ago. And at the time that I did that sketch, I was living in New York City as single, no children, just quit my job at Chase Manhattan Bank and was starting my coaching business. So I just had a teeny tiny coaching business, hadn't written any books or done any of that. I was 30 years old. And I did that picture, and I looked at this thing. I said, oh, my goodness, I've got everything. It's all come true that I had sketched out from this ideal life, all with the exception, I think I'd written down that I'd sketched in a little horse ranch with a little sketch of a horse. And I just don't have a horse ranch. But I got everything else that I wanted, a husband, two children, international speaking career, author, all this stuff, house by the sea. And I wrote down stuff that I thought was absolutely fantastical. And there I got it 10 years later. What was startling to me was thinking, gosh, if I hadn't found this piece of paper, I don't know if I'd realize that actually I'm living my ideal life. Because when you have two small children, I've got a 4 and a 6-year-old, sometimes life just feels very realistic, not very idealistic. So, that's kind of the fun thing is you might realize in doing this exercise that, hey, you've already got your ideal life. Maybe it just needs a little fine-tuning and it'll be perfect. So that's the key thing. First, design your ideal life, and then we'll start looking at the perfect career. Okay, so I don't want to miss that out because after all, I am a life coach, and no good having the perfect career if it doesn't support your ideal life. That's working backwards. That's actually what most people do, unfortunately. And then they wonder why they're not happy. So I had one colleague, and talk about perfect examples, he loved to ski, and he thought, well, I'll coach on Mondays. He was a coach. He said, I'm just going to coach on Mondays and get all my clients in on Monday, and then I'm going to ski the rest of the week. And he did that for a couple of years until he got bored of that and went off and did something different. But talk about structuring your life so that it really supports what you want, which really is ideal. Okay, so just keep your eye on that ideal life first. All right, so now we're going to go over the 9 elements of the perfect career. And all these, I do actually go through these in much greater depth than I will today in my book, Coach Yourself to a New Career. And we go through the steps of changing, finding out what that would be. So we'll cover a good bit of that and give you a good overview of that today in the webinar. So let's move right on to the first in this list here is to identify your abilities and strengths. So when we look at abilities and strengths, we have, since the age about 13 or 14, our brain is wired up to think in a particular way. So, and from the age of 6, we actually can test for musical ability to see if you have the 3 elements that make up musical ability. These are very different from learned skills. Our inherent abilities is really the patterns that our brain seems to form, the things that become easy for us to do, pretty much cement to a fairly large degree by the age of 14, and we don't change that much from then on. I know people think we can change and do anything, but what's actually happening is not so much that your brain is changing, it's that you're learning skills. So on top of your natural hardwired abilities, you can learn skills and become good at things. So you can expand your vocabulary, you can learn to type, you can learn to manage people. So all sorts of things can be learned, and you add those on top. What happens is a lot of times, especially I always, with the natural abilities, what we've discovered is that if you do something that's in alignment with one of your hardwired natural abilities, you'll probably be pretty good at it because it comes naturally to you. So it'll be easy for you to achieve mastery in that, whatever that might be. So that, in terms of changing your career direction, And it has the amazing thing of being really fun. So it's when it's easy for us, it doesn't actually feel like work. And this is the thing where I would like people to take on work that feels like fun as opposed to work. And especially if you're in your retirement, the last thing you want to do in retirement is be slogging it out, having a tough old time. Yeah, enough of that. Let's have some fun here. So the key to having fun and ease is to make sure that whatever you choose to do is in alignment with one of your natural abilities. Now, the question is, how do you find out what these natural abilities are? I did not create this. The Highlands Ability Battery is a fantastic program. I did not invent it. There's over 20 years of research that has gone behind creating this online computerized assessment. But it is the creme de la creme, state-of-the-art assessment, and we use it in my coaching company at lifecoach.com for that reason. It is the best that I know of right now in the market for testing abilities. It does take 3 hours. It's very intense. I'll kid you not. It's a very intense 3 hours. You don't have to do all 3 hours at once. You can do it in 10-minute sections if you want, but it is a very intense battery that at the end of that will give you some 28-page report telling you exactly how your brain is wired up and what you can and can't do. Even things like musical ability can be tested for, even if you've never played a musical instrument. So we can tell you if you, you know, that might be a good idea to pick up an instrument in your retirement, and fiddle around with a band or a banjo, and what instrument even. We can even tell you whether you'd be better off on the piano or the violin, because the pitched instrument requires, a pitched instrument like the violin would require pitch discrimination. But it tells all sorts of interesting things, like I learned why I can't line dance. I discovered that even though I was a successful manager in my banking career and I managed a financial center downtown at Chase before I went into coaching, and although I was successful and got good reviews at that, I was never really fulfilled. And I found out why. It's one of my weaker abilities. Management's really not my strength. And that showed right up on the Highlands program. And in fact, I didn't believe it. I said, well, how can that be true? I was a successful manager. But that's because if you're smart enough and work hard enough, you can be successful at something that's not even one of your natural abilities. And that's kind of a shame, because I think so many times in our life we go through life thinking, yeah, I've had a good career, I've worked hard, and we never really have tapped into something that could have been so much more fun for us, that we could have really enjoyed at a much deeper and more fulfilling level. And those typically are things that are aligned with our natural abilities. So in a career transition, I do encourage my clients to take this battery. It's not cheap. But then getting yourself retrained and going back to school to learn a new career, that's even more expensive. Because if you decided for your new career you need retraining, you go to get re-educated in a different field, that costs time and it costs money. So well worth making sure you're on the right path before you head down that direction. And then, of course, the other resources. Actually, coach yourself to a new career. That is a book I would recommend, because that's more focused on changing your careers in this case. But Coach Yourself to Success, my first book, has a good chapter on that. There's 10 tips in Chapter 6 on that, on identifying your abilities. In fact, well, we'll share one of those right now. So this is the Highlands Ability is the high-tech way, and much, you know, very thorough, the most thorough that I know of right now in the market. Otherwise, I'd be using something else. But we also have a low-tech way to find out what your abilities and talents are, and that is to interview your friends and family and colleagues. And you can print this out and copy it and send it to people if you want, cut and paste, and use these interview questions if you'd like. This does come from Coach Yourself to Success. So these are the questions that I would suggest you ask. You can ask other ones as well, but this will help you figure out, 'cause what happens to people is when we have a unique gift or talent, sometimes it's obvious to people, and that you probably wouldn't be on the phone call with me right now on this webinar if you actually already knew that. So the reason we're a bit mystified, well, what do I do now? What would I really be good at? What am I passionate about? Is because when we're so good at something, it becomes so much a part of us. It's like breathing, and we don't even realize we're doing it. It's like a fish swimming in water. A fish doesn't even know it's swimming in water. It's not aware of that. It's just swimming. It's so natural to it. Fish does not know that it's an excellent swimmer. Pull it out of water, and then it's like, wait a minute, give me back that water. So sometimes it's not until we're removed from something that we can identify our talent or have somebody from the outside help us see that. So I suggest try playing around with these questions and ask people, what do you think is my greatest strength? And then ask them, what is my biggest weakness? Now, only ask that one if you feel up to it. The reason we ask about the weakness side is because typically the flip side of a strength is somebody's weakness. And that helps us identify our greatest strengths. And remember, you're just gathering information here. What do you see as my special talent or gift? If I were on the cover of a magazine, what would the magazine be and what would the story be about? And then when am I most fully expressing this gift and talent? So feel free to use that. That can help you identify what some of your own unique talents are. Any questions at this point, Emily?
We haven't gotten any questions so far, but just to remind folks that they can submit those questions that they have in the question area of their GoToWebinar control panel screen.
Okay. Great. Well, I'll just carry right on. The next piece, one of the other elements of the perfect career, is making sure that the career is a match to your personal style. Now, at this stage in your life, I'm going to assume that you already know if you're an introvert or an extrovert. The key difference between an introvert and extrovert is introverts recharge and get their energy by being alone or in solo activities, whereas extroverts get their energy from external activities and events and from other people. So an extrovert actually needs to be around people to recharge, and an introvert needs to be alone to recharge. And so that's a simple question. By this time, you can answer that and find out. But obviously, you're going to want a career that matches your personal style. If you're an introvert, no good going for a sales position. Another part of personal style is how long can you think into the future? We can actually test this on the Highlands as well, to tell how long your brain goes into the future. I never realized this until I did the Highlands program myself, that not everybody can imagine, you know, or think 5 to 10 years or even 20 years into the future. Some people have a really short time frame, and they can only think about 0 to 6 months or maybe to a year, and then they can't really imagine what would happen after that. I mean, it just kind of amazed me because I have a very long time frame, and so I can imagine things happening 20, 40 years from now. But not everybody does. Some people, if you ask, what are you going to do 5 years from now, draw a complete blank. So again, our brains don't always go that far into the future. Some people have very short time frames, some have medium, and some have long. So very interesting question. That if you're in if you have a short time frame, you'll be do better in a job that's more tactical, with the let's get things done now. And if you have a long time frame, you'll be good at, say, the strategic planning. You know, where is this going to, you know, being on that kind of committee, thinking into the future. So, and then the next question is, are you a specialist or a generalist? Now this one's a tricky one because I actually thought I was a generalist. A generalist is somebody who's good at a lot of things and knows a little bit about a lot of different things. And so it's pretty good, but not really super good at any one thing. And a specialist tends to be really good at one thing and go into great depth on that one thing and focus on that. So I didn't actually realize, I thought I was a generalist, but it was only because I actually hadn't found my passion or my specialty. And once I'd found that, which was coaching, I dove right in and went really deep. So I kind of was, people would have said I was a generalist because I sort of dibbled in this and that and wasn't particularly good at anything, but just kind of good at a lot of things. But I'm actually a specialist, and it was just discovering my specialty. So good thing for you to know if you're a specialist or a generalist, and if you are a specialist, it's helpful to know if you actually found your specialty. So that's the key there. The specialists, there's only, specialists are 20% of the population. Generalists are 80% of the population, so different sorts of people. For these, we have the Highlands Assessment as resources and also another computerized assessment we use called the DISC Assessment and the Personal Interests and Attitudes and Values. These are 10-minute assessments. They take very little time and can tell you kind of what your personal style is. So good stuff there. We also then go on to values and passions. Now, values are obviously what's most important to you. Value is something that is of value to you. And passions are what you love to do. So if you could imagine that you had all the money in the world, you didn't have to worry about making money, and this may be you in your retirement life, and you could do anything you wanted, what would it be? So we have a couple of exercises to help you figure that out. One of them that I like, actually I'll pull out the one that's my favorite, it's called the Envy Method. And one of the best, one of the easiest ways for me as a coach to figure out what a client really wants to do is ask them who they envy and why. Because if we envy somebody, that means we secretly want what they have, whatever that might be. So if they've got, I don't know, you might envy a best-selling author or something like that, or a motivational speaker, you think, oh, wow, I really wish I could do that. That's what you want to do. But for some reason, you think you can't do that. So I like that method because it shows right off, I think of envy as green for go for it. It shows us what you actually want to do, but for some reason think you can't. Now maybe you can't, but it's worth a conversation because more often than not, people actually can go for what they want. They just think they can't. So that's where a coach comes in handy. The other resource that's kind of handy on this, finding out where your values, is just a list of values. Now, I've got that in Coach Yourself to a New Career, but we're going to give you that as a resource as well on the Facebook page. So if you go to Life Coach Tribe on Facebook, we're Life Coach Tribe. If you go there, well, I'll give you the link at the end. If you link through that, you will find the values list on the Facebook page. You just like the page, and you will get to that. It's on the wall, and you can access it. It's a PDF file, and you can print it out. And that program, it's called the True Values Program, is a program designed to help you figure out and identify what your true values are, what your passions are, and then start to orient your life around that. Really, really useful tool. So I definitely recommend taking a look at that list. Identify your values from that, and then work backwards and say, okay, if these are my values, here's the other exercise that's helpful with that, is to look at what the highlights of your life were. So this is another method I use. Think back through your life. What were the best times? If you imagine you're about to get hit by a bus and your whole life flashes before you and you have a giant yellow highlighter and you could just highlight the peak experiences in your life, the very best times, whether it was a whole year in your life that was fantastic or whether it was just a short period of time. Take that highlighter and write those things down. What were those best times of your life? Now you've got the list of that. Go back to the values list and see what the underlying value was behind that peak experience that made it so great. So I'll just give you an example. One of my values is travel and adventure. And one of my peak experiences was when I spent my junior year abroad living in Salamanca, Spain. Now that year abroad, for me, I got to go, I traveled all around Europe, I traveled all around Spain, had loads of adventures. It was just a fantastic year where I got to do mostly a lot of traveling and have a lot of adventures. Of course, I did study as well, but that was a side benefit of being in Spain. That year would just get a complete yellow highlight through the whole entire year. So it was just one incredible year, and I'll never forget it. So that would definitely fit into the peak experiences highlights list. And when I look at why was that year so great, it's because it's related to those values of travel and adventure. So that's how you can look at your experiences and say, okay, well, how do I translate that? Because once you identify the core value beneath it, then it's easier to say, okay, travel and adventure. Well, how can I create travel and adventure in my life now that I have two children? A different question. So, you know, working that into your life and family and situation as you have now could be a very different thing. But knowing that makes all the difference because maybe an adventure for me now is going to the town next door and eating dinner at a new restaurant. Okay, so that's a little mini adventure. Easier to do when you have small children than flying off someplace. Okay, so the games you played as a child as well is a great way to look at what were the core values because children are just pure and innocent. And the things you did as a child can indicate what your core values are. So that's the idea here is we want to get your whole life oriented around living these values, especially now that you're going into retirement and doing a career now. You want to be able to choose something that's going to be really fulfilling to you and a match for that so that it feels like you're on vacation, so that your work feels like fun. So I know I've covered a lot very quickly so far. Are there any questions at this point?
We have one question related to the aptitude assessment. Someone wants to know if they can use an old Johnson O'Connor aptitude assessment that they did when they were in their teenage years. They're obviously now much older.
I wouldn't use one of those. The aptitude assessments aren't nearly as good as the stuff that you can get now. It's probably a bit out of date. If you did the Highlands, that would still actually work, but it's only, I don't think the Highlands is more than 25 years old. But the aptitude assessments are a little, I think they're a little different. I mean, if you find it helpful, dig it back out and take a look at it. It might shed some new light on possible new directions for you. I think when I did that, it said I could end up being a shoe salesperson. So I did go into sales in the banking, but, you know, I just wasn't terribly impressed with that. It's not, I don't think it's as good as the Highlands program. We'd be using that one. can't hurt. I mean, there's so many different programs and things out there. If you've got a tool that sheds some light on the direction that you want to go, well, by all means, dig it out and take a look at it and see if that sparks anything for you. But I do think at this point in your life, it may be worth investing in getting a new tool and taking stuff, because even the old tools have been improved upon. Even if just redoing one of the old ones you've already done might help too. So, but yeah, give yourself a fresh shot. They in some sense, they might be the same, but things might change. You know, they might change, and those aptitude assessments, I don't think, are as thorough. But if it does shed light, you know, sometimes we just need to look at something from the past and say, oh, yeah, actually, I always wanted to do this. And that sparks us getting us into the right direction.
One other quick question we have is someone on the line wants to know your thoughts that if they know what they're good at and that relates to their passions and values, what do they do if that specific industry or field in the job market right now is terrible in terms of hiring and just the industry in general?
Well, in that case, you might want to, you know, because if you know what you're good at, I always say, if you know what you're good at, and that's the whole thing, you already know what you love to do. It's already in alignment with what your talents are, but there's no money to be made in that at the moment. A couple of things. There's always room for good people at the top, so I would still think about that and see, but maybe you need to circumvent that and either start your own business at it so you're instantly at the top and don't have to worry about getting hired by somebody else. So I don't know what the nature of your business is, but you might consider starting your own business in it and setting up solo camps so nobody hires you. And if you're really good at it, you might steal their customers away anyway, because if you're truly good at something and love it, well, you will attract people to you who want your services. So that's one thing, is you may consider setting up, you know, avoiding getting hired if they're not hiring, and just set up as a competitor. That's one way around it. But the other way around it might be to look at, okay, I'm good at this. What are those core abilities underneath there that my talents are? And what are some other fields or other jobs that use this that are currently available now? So you might want to say, how can I translate this and still keep the same values and passions, keep abilities and use those, but in a different field or different career? And that might be the thing to say is, you know, this is. I remember once working with a guy who was a hedge fund manager who just lost his job because all the hedge fund managers were axed in the recent financial collapse. And this guy was in London, and he just could not. I said, well, you've got lots of things you could do. You don't just have to be a hedge fund manager. You've got all sorts of different abilities. He just was so locked on just doing that one thing that he was sort of blinded, like a horse wearing blinders, and just sticking on that one track. Take your blinders off and see how you can, what other jobs might also be fulfilling for you. So you probably have other things you could do as well. And maybe those industries are a little more vibrant. We can hope. But I would look at the other options you might have that you're not considering there. A really good question. Anything else at the moment?
I think that's it for now.
Okay, we'll move on to personal and emotional needs. Now, not most of your career books will not talk about personal and emotional needs. I think this is a big oversight, because if you aren't getting your personal needs met and your emotional needs met, it could really make that career miserable, even if it matches up with your abilities and your values and passions. So I'll give you an example. For example, if you need to be independent and free, and you're working for a boss who micromanages you, I don't care how wonderful that job is and if it's a match for your abilities and it's your passions, you'll just chafe working against this micromanaging boss if you have a need to be independent and free. So your personal need to be independent is going to be more important and could spoil what could be a really nice job for you. So this is why it's so important to know what our needs are. And this is not something that people ever talk about. So I have created a free quiz. Don't do it now because it does take about 20 minutes. But if you go to the homepage at lifecoach.com and you'll see there's a free emotional index quiz, you can take that quiz, and at the end it'll tell you. It'll sort out over 100 different needs, and it'll tell you what your own top four needs are. So it's very important to think about that, because it's very hard to have an ideal career and be happy in our work if it's a clash with one of our needs or if it doesn't align with our needs properly. Those actually take precedence over values. So you could do something and say, yeah, this is a perfect match for me, but I hate my boss. So this is where you could get into trouble. Knowing what you need makes it easier to say, you know what, as much as I love that job, I'll never be able to work for this type of person. Now, as we get older, we tend to be able to, we know more about what do we need, but this sort of clarity and saying, okay, these are my top four needs, having that kind of clarity before you take a job or start your own business or anything will make you more aware of that and more likely to prevent problems and unhappiness from not getting them met in your situation, whatever that might be. So that's another great tool that you can use. Absolutely free. Take advantage of that and find out what your needs are. So quick hit there. Moving on to interests, goals, family, career cycle, and other practical considerations. So I know this seems incredibly obvious, but it's useful to think about, well, what are you interested in? What magazines do you read in your spare time? Maybe there's a career that you could go there for your retirement career, because if you're already enjoying it and have an interest in it, maybe there's a way we can expand that. And it may sound crazy. I had a client who said, "Wow, my interests and my passions are dogs and wine." She said, "I love dogs, and I actually, in my spare time, work at a dog shelter and hang around with dogs, and I love hanging around with dogs. But there's, how am I going to make money with dogs?" And I said, "Well, you could, dog walking, I can't make very much money in that." She was a director at a law firm of the human resources department, so she was making, perfectly great money at that. And so she said, "Well, dogs," and then she also liked wine. So we thought, it could be a wine taster, work in the wine industry or something like that, but none of that quite jobs. But the dog thing did, and she ended up creating her own business, which was an upscale dog daycare business in Austin, Texas, called Hip Hounds. And she said, "I can talk about her, so it's okay." But her book, she's in my book as well, the Hip Hounds was her business, designed to give organic dog food, super fabulous care for people who are off at work all day and don't want their dogs all lonely and at home being miserable. So anyway, this is what she created in the middle of the recession. She started this luxury business, and it has been very successful, and it was successful even in the middle of a recession. A luxury business like that you'd think would never take off, but it did. People love their dogs. So she is, absolutely a happy camper, orienting her business around her passions for dog and her interests and her values, which is very, very important to her, that everything was well taken care of, high-end and organic. So here you go. Yeah, whatever interests you may actually lead you to your next career. You may have certain goals. You might have come back to work because you need to make a certain amount of money if you've just lost your entire stock portfolio in the recent recession. There may be financial reasons. So it may not be that you could choose. You have certain goals. That's something else to consider. The ideal career should meet your financial goals and other objectives as well. Perhaps you have children that you want to support or fund their educations, or you want to live nearby. Maybe you want to leave a legacy, a particular fund, an art, trust fund or something. Who knows what, whatever you want to do. Those may all fit into the sorts of career that you'd be interested in doing or the business that you'd want to start. And of course, in your career development cycle, even if you'd love to be a surgeon, it's unlikely you'd get into medical school if you're over 45. So certain realistic considerations, if you may want to be a wood chopper or something, but if you physically don't have the stamina for that, that may not be the best thing for you. So, different considerations happen, and as we get older, they're just things to consider. And that's all important. That all goes into the mix. So it's worth taking some time to think, okay, well, actually, these things are really important to me. I need to make sure that this career will support that. Okay, some tips on how those are pretty much the elements that you'll want to consider. And of course, I've gone over them very quickly in not great depth. So I do recommend giving yourself some time to really work through these. There's loads of exercises in Coach Yourself to a New Career that you can think about and work with, and this will just get you started. What I've given you today is a lot of ways that you can get started on thinking about things, what sort of things you should be thinking about as you're looking at, okay, what do I do next, and how do I know what would be the right thing for me now? And those are all the questions. And actually, most of these things, we do the exact same process whether you're 20 years old and just getting out of school, or whether you're 65 and thinking, okay, now what do I do? Because ideally, I want people who are 20 to be in their perfect career right from the get-go and not have to suffer and struggle so much. So, you know, wherever you are, these are the same sort of criteria that we use to create the ideal career for anybody. Now, when you're coming back from a retirement situation, you'll have to realize there could be some difficulties. If you've been out of the workforce for a while, that might present a challenge because there's a lot of competition. And right now, this is a fact that has been reported in the newspaper. Employers are prejudiced right now against unemployed people. And there's sort of an on-the-street thinking that if you've been unemployed, then you're no good, and you probably should stay unemployed. And there's been a preference for people who are employed in terms of getting jobs. So what I'm saying is, and this has always been the truth, it's always easier to get a job if you're already employed. And that's always been the case. But right now, because of the recession in America, this is even worse. So now, not having a job and coming back, you have to know going in that you'll probably get a bit of rejection. So just be prepared that there'll be some rejection. There may be a lot of rejection because people are prejudiced against unemployed people right now, more than ever. All right? Other thing to be aware of is that because of that, it may make sense to start any sort of work, get some small job so that you can, and get a professional. Don't bother doing your resume yourself unless you're a professional resume writer. Get a professional to get your resume up to speed and up to date. Things have changed, and depending on which industry you're looking at going back into, you need a professional who understands what that industry expects in terms of a resume and getting your resume to look great. Professionals make all the difference in this, so I wouldn't even bother writing your own. Just go see a resume writing service and get that done. I don't have any to recommend to you at the moment, but I'm sure you could find one in your area. And actually, there's probably been some webinars on resume writing. I bet you there are some in the archives already at Georgetown on resume writing. And if I were to go back and not have my own business and go work for somebody, I wouldn't even consider writing my own resume now because I've been out of the workforce too long. I need to know, I wouldn't know what style of resume they're looking for, what how they lay it out, you know, nothing. So I would just go and get a professional to do that for you. It's a small fee compared to the results that you'll get. But the number one way people get jobs is by networking. And people always prefer to hire the known over the unknown. So if you're a known person, a known entity, they are going to be more likely to hire than if you're a complete unknown. So how do you get known by somebody? You get great references. And I just hired somebody from my company solely based on a fantastic reference from somebody I trusted. So if you really trust somebody and they say this person is great, you may even hire them with just a cursory interview because you trust so much the person who recommended them. And this is more often how people get hired. It's because somebody they trust says this person's great, get them in. Okay, so now if you've been off golfing for a while and you know, use your golf buddies, use your friends to say, hey, you know, do you know anybody in this industry? And get them to help give you a reference. Don't try to go in on your own. Use your connections, use your network to help get you started. And the first thing to ask for is an informational interview. So an informational interview isn't asking for a job. It's not even implying that you want a job. It's implying that you want information. You say, oh, can I take you out for lunch or buy you a drink after dinner or something? Meet you for breakfast one morning and ask you about your business, your field, something I'm thinking of getting back into or something transitioning into, and I'd love to learn more about that. People who love what they do love talking about what they do. And so if you offer to buy them lunch and say, can I treat you to lunch at this, you know, nice little restaurant, they'll be more likely to say yes, and they would love that. And then you can just pick their brains and find out. Ask them all sorts of questions. Well, what's it like to work there? What kind of work do you do? How did you get started in this industry? What training did you need? What do you recommend for somebody trying to get in now? Don't imply that you want the job. Just find out the information about it and to ask your questions. These are very powerful. And if you really go in there, honestly, just looking for information, a lot of times people get job offers because they're so good at doing the informational interviews, and they end up being job offers. But don't go in there because that would be a bit deceptive. Don't go in there saying, oh, I'm looking for a job in this industry. Instead, say, I'm trying to find out more and learn more about this industry, okay, or this career, or what it's like. And then use your contacts to get those interviews. That's the best thing. And then they say, you know, go in, have your super, once you decide, yes, I want to go into this industry or this field or have this job, get your professional resume done, tailor-made for that particular job, and have it made very specifically for that. Then you go in and have your real interview, okay? And some people just skip that whole thing, but it's good to have your resume ready so that when you go in, you've got that set to go, right? You can try, if you're not sure, experiment. You can do some experimenting by taking classes in the subject and seeing if that interests you. Again, you'll start meeting people who can point you in the right direction if you're in a class doing some adult education classes or going back to university. If you want to start a business, just start small, low risk, small scale, experiment with it, see what happens, see if it starts to grow. I think some of the most successful businesses were just started as people were experimenting with stuff and then they grew. eBay is a prime example of that. The Zagat's Guide, you know, the Zagat's Guides for restaurants, that started with a woman and her, I think it was a woman and her husband, liked to eat out, and they just made a list of their favorite restaurants and photocopied them and sent them with brief descriptions to their friends. And then their friends added onto it, and before you know it, you had the Zagat Guides, which has became a huge business in itself. So, you know, starting with something as simple as, you know, handing out a list of recommended restaurants on a photocopied sheet of paper to your friends evolved into a huge business and a very successful one. So, you know, your business idea that you start on a small scale, start that. Start making the photocopies. I think the book Creative Visualization by Shakti Gawain, she photocopied that and was selling it, taking it to stores, bookstores, and saying, oh, we do sell these. And they kept running out of them, and then she got a publisher. She attracted the attention of a publisher afterwards. Very hard to do that now with publishing, but online publishing would be easier. But anyway, take your business idea, experiment with it on a small scale, set up a free, you can get websites done for free, you know, don't spend a lot of money in it, test it out, see if your idea works before you invest a lot of money. So, questions about, we didn't talk about the elevator speech. Once you've done your work here, you know, I've given you all these things that you can do to identify and get very articulate about what it is that you want to do. Then you get your elevator speech down pat so that when somebody says, well, what is it that you're interested in doing, you have a one-line, two-line maximum zingy statement that very clearly articulates exactly what you're looking for. The shorter it is, the better. One line is ideal. Okay, but you want people to, that way they can say, oh, gosh, I know somebody who's that, you know, and they can tell their friends, hey, I know a guy who's looking for this, and it's very clear and articulate, and you've nailed it down. It's no good doing something. I made this mistake early on in my career when I was talking to a guy, and I really wanted to work in his company. He was a consultant doing sort of coaching work early on in Connecticut, and I so wanted to work in his business. And he was impressed by me. I was taking a seminar he was leading, and I knew he was impressed by me, and he asked me point blank, and he said, well, what is it you want to do? And I sort of stammered and muttered and said, well, I'm good with people. I'm a people person. Oh, come on. I mean, that is so vague. I'm a people person. And so that's just not helpful. So you need to have a clear, articulate statement when somebody says, what would you like to do? And make sure you've got that down and you can have that ready to go. I did not get that job with that company, by the way. So and it all turned out fine because I started my own business even better. But yeah, there you go. So do make sure you have that ready to go on your elevator speech, so you don't sound like the dimwit that I did when asked that question. Let's see, what else can we talk about? Some resources. There's loads of different books here. I started Coach Yourself to a New Career because that's 7 steps. We've gone over some of them, but they go into more depth here in the book. And there's exercises in there that you can work on to help create the clarity of exactly what your ideal career profile is and what you'd like to do. For more information, if you want to do the Highlands or some of these other computerized assessments, feel free to contact me at Talane@lifecoach.com, and we'll get back to you as to how you can take those. We've got a couple more upcoming events here for Georgetown. I'm doing these webinars in June and July, Coaching Skills for Managers, and Identify the Work You Love. Actually, that's going to be similar to one we've just done, so you may not want to do that one. But yeah, we've got Coaching Skills for Managers coming up, as well as there's a whole list of other webinars that other fantastic people are leading at the Georgetown website here. So check this out and see if there's anything else of interest. I do seem to recall there was one on resume writing as well, if that's something you need. This is our contact information, so feel free to sign up. Facebook.com, the Life Coach Tribe, that's where we are. That's where you can get the True Values program. That's free as well. And at lifecoach.com, you can get the emotional index quiz I talked about for finding out what your top four needs are. That's free. There's loads of other free resources on there that you can take advantage of. So like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. And I'm going to be using YouTube at the moment. There's nothing much there, so I wouldn't bother with that yet, but that'll be coming soon. So anything, we do have, some special offers for you. And I just mentioned this VIP page on Facebook. You can find the resources for Georgetown alums set up there, a special VIP tab. So if you click on that on the Life Coach Tribe, you'll find us there. And we are offering a program, online coaching program. It's a year-long program, 52 weeks of coaching yourself to success online. So it's interactive, but you do it on your own pace, get a weekly coaching assignment through your emails, and have an online goal tracker, interactive forums. It's all very state-of-the-art. And you end up coaching yourself with some support, as much or as little as you wish. That it's only $1 to try it out for 7 days, so no risks there. And then after that, it's only $19.95 a month, so very inexpensive way to get started with coaching if that's something you're interested in working through. If you want to do the speedy program and just hire a coach independently, we are also available for that. So feel free to contact me if you are interested in coaching, and I can always recommend a coach for you, if I'm not the right coach for you as well. We've got a whole team of coaches working in our company. So does anybody have any questions at this time? We have a few more minutes.
Yeah, sure. We do have a couple questions. Just to remind folks that you can still submit your questions through the question area of your GoToWebinar control panel. Just to specifically touch on a couple points Talane did already, we do have multiple archived webinars on resume writing and also transitioning back into the workforce. So if you go to our website and click on our webinar archive, you can view these. They're actually tagged by category, so they should be all very easy to find. Talane, one of our specific questions we've received is, we have an attendee on the line that is fighting to get back into her career field, which she left 2 years ago due to a family health crisis. She wants to go back into the field as a full-time employee, but was recommended into the business by a colleague. She went through the interview process multiple rounds, and then after the final round, the hiring manager said that they would rather bring her on as a consultant or specialist, that they felt like she was too senior to come in as a full-time employee for the position. Do you have any tips on folks that might be having this type of situation when they don't want to be doing consulting work or be a specialist or an entrepreneur, but just rather a regular full-time staff?
Well, I do think there's huge, remember I said earlier, there's people prefer, they like to hire the known over the unknown. And given the recession, right now, they may only be able to hire you on a consulting basis. If that's a job you really are keen on and really like, best to get your foot in the door. You know, so if your foot in the door is as a consultant, say, look, I'll work with you now as a consultant on a consulting basis. Now, one thing you should know about being a consultant, consultants get to charge a whole lot more than employees because you have to pay for your own benefits and your own stuff. So I would say you say yes to that, obviously assuming you want to, and say yes to it because it will get you that foot in the door. So, you know, if you've tried your competitors and, you know, you may want to try your competitors first, but you would say, you know, get your foot in the door, and then while you're working there, you could still try your competitors because as a consultant, you're a free agent. And so there's no reason why you couldn't work with other businesses. And have them, let them know that your intention is that you will do that, and as they can afford to, or the recession improves and their business picks up, you'd like to be first on the list for applying for a full-time position when that opens up. But there is a lot to be said to being actively engaged in that business and then you'll be a prime candidate for moving into that full time when those positions do open up, and if they do. At least in the meantime, you'll be, you know, in there, making your contacts, becoming a more and more valued person, and will be able to segue into the positions as soon as things start sparking up again in the economy. All right, so do think getting your foot in the door, even if it's not exactly what you wanted, brings you one step closer to something that is what you want. So worth doing.
Thank you. We've gotten a bunch of questions about the slides being available. And just to remind everyone, we'll be emailing out the slides, and then also we'll go into a couple details in a second on how you can also access a copy of the presentation through Facebook. Talane, we've gotten a couple questions related to ageism and getting back into the workforce, related to someone, you know, quickly kind of rebranding themselves. Do you have any quick tips for someone before they go into an interview to make themselves kind of appear hip and up to date and current with, you know, fashion and the culture?
Very, very good question. Ageism exists, and it's very hard to combat that, but you can do that. I always think of Ronald Reagan. He was one of our older presidents in America, and if you noticed, when he walked up to give a speech on stage, he didn't just walk up. He bounded onto the stage with youthful enthusiasm and energy, and he bounded. So you can counter age with some physical movement. So, you know, instead of walking sedately, you know, be energetic and enthusiastic and, you know, bound a little bit. So you might want to look at some of those old talks and watch how Ronald Reagan did that, because he was very masterful, you know, in projecting youthfulness, because that was one of the things that people criticized, oh, he's too old. And so you can project an air of youthfulness and energy and enthusiasm, and you can do that with body language. So take a look at that. Now, the other part of that is, know what the current fashions are and trends in your industry before you go in. This is helpful if you can find a lot out of that by just snooping around. So one of my things in terms of snooping around is, let's say you want to work in a particular office, you know, hang out in their lobby for a bit and see what people wear. See if you can hang out in the lobby or outside the office. You know, obviously you don't want to create the presence that somebody's going to think you're lurking around in a negative way. But, you know, subtly hang out and see what people are wearing. Observe the current trends and fashion so that when you do go on these interviews, you look the part. Looking the part is very important. And it makes people feel comfortable if you're in the right stuff, that you don't want to look dated. You don't want to be wearing your old suit from 20 years ago. Lapel sizes have changed. Do not think that you can get away with that. So, you know, you may want to go to an image consultant if it's been a long time since you've had your wardrobe done. Go to an image consultant or go to one of the higher-end department stores, and they can have a personal shopper for you and tell them, you know, this is the field I'm going into. I need to look appropriate to this. And that you might find that they can be helpful. So, you know, image consultant, a good image consultant should be aware of the kinds of clothes that would be appropriate to different industries and fields. But again, a little bit of snooping around is a good thing. Your informational interviews can then further consolidate that information. So hopefully you've done that. You're in the right attire for your informational interview, but then you can fine-tune it by looking closely at what that person's wearing, and any advice that they might have could be helpful as well. So you do want to have your resume look up to date. Up to date, everything is going to be really key. Get yourself on Facebook, because now everybody looks at your Facebook profile. So if you don't have Facebook, already you're aging yourself, because you're out of the loop. The communication loop now is Facebook, which is why I'm not going to send you this and make it easy for you. If you don't have Facebook, get onto it. It's free. Figure it out. Learn it. Because if you don't, you're going to be left in the dust. It's like saying years ago, about 14 years ago when I started doing classes, we did phone classes. It would be like saying, well, I can't take that class because I don't have a telephone. Well, get a phone and you're out of the loop. Same now is Facebook. It's like saying, well, I don't have a Facebook account. Well, get one. This is, if you're going to be up to date and current, you're going to have to go with the current trends, and that means having a Facebook profile. Make sure your Facebook profile, people will look at that to kind of get a sense, well, who is this person? So, you know, get your friends, your children to come, or even your grandchildren, to say, you know, how's am I doing on my Facebook page? So does this look right? And make sure that that's good. And have your friends in the industry take a look at your Facebook profile. People will look at it. They're going to want to see What do you have on there? What kind of person are you? So that's an important piece to consider as well as part of your branding. And we do have a recorded webinar that was on branding. We talked about branding yourself and rebranding yourself. But it's one that I've led as well for Georgetown. And that's in the Georgetown archive. So check that out because you can listen to that one. That's a pretty good one. We talk all about rebranding yourself. Any other questions?
Thank you so much. Unfortunately, that leaves us out of time today, Talane. I want to thank you. We've gotten numerous comments from folks on the line saying this has been really helpful and informative and valuable. So thank you so much. And I'm going to turn it over to you if you have any last-minute comments.
Just encourage you all to come onto Facebook and get your True Values program there. So if you haven't already set up your account, and I'm looking forward to interacting with you there. And you can always, of course, email me at talane@lifecoach.com. If I didn't get to your question today, I'm more than happy to answer it later. So feel free to email me directly or preferably through Facebook. So looking forward to hearing from you, and thanks for having me, Emily.
All right. Well, thanks so much, Talane, and thanks everyone on the line for joining us, and we hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.